thing that she was in it.
The order, the Rockingham County Board of Elections meeting, our regular meeting for August the 20th, 2024, at 10 o'clock a.m. at the Rockingham County Governmental Center, 371 North 65, Reidsville, North Carolina. We'd like to welcome those of you who are here with us, and we'd like to welcome those of you who are watching via Zoom in the comfort of your homes or in the comfort of your office. We would like to ask you to stand as member Nelson Cole will lead us in the Pledge of Allegiance, and it will be followed by invocation, our stand-in individual who's here, Reverend Wally White, will give us our invocation.
Pledge allegiance
to the flag of the United States of America
and to the republic for which it stands,
one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
All right. Well, the spirit is at work, because last week I saw the email of the meeting, and I was like, oh, I hadn't been in a while, and put it in my phone with an alarm. So I guess I needed to be here. All right, we take this time. I invite you to close your eyes if that's comfortable for you. And just find that place of gratitude, that gratitude for this place that we call home in this county, for the work that the people all across this building, and specifically the people who have stepped forward in this board to do this important work for this entire county and all the residents. We say, thank you, God. Thank you, God. Thank you, God. And so it is. Amen.
Thank you, Reverend Wally White, for standing in for Pastor Ian Pace, Penn Memorial Church, Reidsville. At this time, I would like to entertain a motion for the approval of the agenda.
So moved.
Second.
It has been moved and properly second that we approve the agenda. Is there any discussion? All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed, by saying nay. You have approved the agenda for today. At this time, I'd like to call for a motion for the approval of board minutes, July 16th, 2024, our regular meeting minutes.
Madam Chair, I recommend that we approve the minutes as presented.
Do I have a second?
Second.
It has been motioned and second that we approve the minutes for July 16th, 2024, our regular meeting minutes. Is there any discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed say nay. You have approved the minutes for July 16th. At this time, I'd like to open our meeting for public comments, and Paula will read some information.
Hey, the public comment period shall be for the purpose of allowing members of the public to present any matter pertaining to the Board of Elections business or items on the Board of Elections agenda. Remarks shall be addressed directly to the Board of Elections and not to staff, the audience, or media. The chair shall open the public comment period, and any speaker who wishes to speak shall approach the podium and not speak from his or her seat. Each speaker shall clearly state his or her name and physical address when he or she approaches the podium. Each speaker shall be allotted 3 minutes.
Okay, we have one person who would like to make public comments this morning, Lisa Harris.
Good morning, Board of Elections members. My name is Lisa Harris, 311 Short Avenue. Thank you for your continued dedication to ensure fair and accessible elections in our community. I come before you today to encourage the board to consider expanding our efforts in voter education, particularly through increasing community advocacy. Our voters need more opportunities to engage with the electoral process, especially those who have faced barriers such as lack of information or access to proper identification. One particular step that could be considered is what other counties are doing, is making the voter ID mobile machine for staff to have in the community. I do applaud each of you for the time and the energy that you have spent encouraging staff to make sure they're in the community. That is extremely appreciated. Staff spent a lot of time creating literature. As I walked in this morning, I noticed that in this governmental building, we have some very valuable literature about absentee ballots, curbside ballot, and even the early voting schedule. The bad thing about it is, whoever designated downstairs, that probably is not a Board of Election staff member, they put it behind a glass. So unfortunately, as citizens come in the building, it's behind a glass, and if someone's away from that desk, they don't have an opportunity to just graze through those. So I'm hoping that you will consider looking into that accessibility. That's a great example of accessibility. As we continue to move through all the items on the agenda today, I just wanted to note that as we demonstrate in our community the intentions of this election, we understand it's full of a lot of energy, and we need to make sure our staff are prepared, both financially as relates to sufficient staff members, as well as materials and resources. I understand you all don't need anything extra on your plate, but I will ask you to strongly consider in your voter education to increase things such as videos that the community can see from staff and from Board of Election members with factual information about frequently asked questions about absentee ballots. Thank you so much for the time to speak. Thank you.
Thank you, Lisa Harris. There is no one else signed up for our public comments. I'd like to close the public comment period at this time. And we will move on to item number 7 on the agenda, 2024 general election precinct officials. Paula Seamster.
You'll notice in your packets there is a list of the early voting chief judges and judges for the 4 early voting sites. And I am asking the board for approval of these chief judges and judges for the early voting period time.
Board members, you've had your packet by email, and do you need more time to look at it now? If you're like I am, you'd like to see it right in front of you on paper. So if you need just a little time to look at it, or if you have questions.
I have a question, Madam Chair. I'm looking at the Reidsville voting site, and I guess John Harris took Frank's place.
That is correct.
Any other questions? If not, at this time, I'd like to entertain a motion.
Madam Chair, I make a motion that we approve the list of the early voting chief judges and judges as presented by our director, Ms. Seamster.
And do I have a second?
Second.
All right, it has been moved and properly seconded that we receive the general list of chief judges and judges that our director has looked over and has given to us and is recommending Is there any discussion?
Madam Chair, I just wanted to ask, this appears to be the same individuals that were serving in the last election. Is that correct?
That is correct. There are a few changes, but that is correct. We usually have about the same judges and chief judges.
Right. And they may be switched. They may be in different locations, but
that is correct.
That's what I was looking at. Okay.
Okay. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, say no. You have approved the chief judges and officials.
Next is election day chief judges and judges. And that you'll see is actually three pages, and it's for all 15 sites. So if you'll just take a few minutes to review that. We have made changes to that as well. We've had to move some of our judges around because of circumstances that have happened this year to two of our chief judges. So we have moved some of our judges up into the chief judge role. And so you all know as well, a letter was sent out to the three political parties in June asking for recommendations for chief judges and judges for early voting and voting. They had until last Thursday to submit their list, but I just wanted to make the board aware of that. That is part of the new law that took place on January 1, that they have to be given the opportunity to submit their recommendations, and we have to give them at least 30 days, and we actually gave them a little over 60 days to do that.
Are any of the, Madam Chair, question?
Yes.
Are there any of the people that we have listed here new to this role of judge or chief judge?
Yes. Draper, Brian Mills, will be new as a chief judge. Matrimony, Cole Matoka, is new as chief judge. And then at Mall Street, John Harris served as a chief judge at a different precinct, but we've moved him to Mall Street. But the rest of the chief judges remain the same. Oh, I'm sorry, and Stacy Joyce in Lincoln. She served as a chief judge in matrimony at the last election, and she will be serving as a fill-in chief judge at Lincoln because the chief judge will not be in town during election.
Good to have experience.
It is.
And board members, you, as you can see, she indicated the political party beside each of the chief judges, and so that's there for you to see.
Did we have any request for consideration for Libertarian Party?
No, sir.
If you have no other questions or comments, I'd like to entertain a motion.
Madam Chair, I make a motion that we accept the list of the election judges, chief judges and judges for election day. I make a motion we accept that list as presented.
It has been moved and properly seconded that we accept the list of election day chief judges and judges. Is there any discussion? Hearing none, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All opposed say nay. You have approved the election day chief judges and judges.
Okay, next on the list is precinct officials. You will see that we have workers who have previously worked, and we're trying to putting the year and the election that they started serving in so that you as board members will know that going forward. You'll notice that the first four and a half pages are precinct officials that have worked other elections. And then you'll see the new workers. We've been conducting orientations for the precinct officials as they are submitting applications that they are interested. We are scheduling orientations to make sure that they understand what the requirements are, what the duties are, the hours, the pay. We're trying to make sure that they know what the job entails prior to agreeing to be a precinct official. And these are the new workers that all of their information has been submitted to Human Resources and are ready to start serving as precinct officials. On the last page, we were waiting on paperwork for this individual. He did bring everything by yesterday and has been submitted to payroll. And then you'll notice there are previous workers. We're still researching on when they actually started. It has been numerous years, but what I'm asking the board today is to approve all of these precinct officials so that we'll be able to use them during the 2024 general election. And we are still conducting precinct official orientations. We have one tomorrow. And we're encouraging if there are citizens of Rockingham County that are interested in serving as precinct officials to contact our office so that we can schedule them to come in and actually attend one of our orientation sessions. But at this point, I'm just asking for approval of this list that is in your packet today.
Board members, do you have any questions for her?
Paula, I noticed on, I don't know what page this is, off the very last page, there's a NEO beside of Millen Mark. Marco, what does NEO mean?
That is new, and that they've attended the employee orientation.
Okay. So they've started the process.
Yes.
I'd like to entertain a motion to approve the 2024 general election precinct officials at this time.
So moved.
Second.
It has been moved and properly second that we approve the 2024 general election precinct officials. Is there any discussion? Hearing none. All in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
All opposed say nay. You have approved the 2024 general election precinct officials as listed. All right, at this time, Paula will give us our updates.
Okay, the first one is the 2024 general election information. In your package, you have a schedule of everything that will be coming up. This schedule is actually located on the Rockingham County Board of Elections website. If any of the citizens would like to know any information regarding the 2024 election that is coming up, we try to put that information on our website as it is made available. Any changes, we try to put those on our website. We're sending that information also out to the Sunshine List. If any of the citizens want to be added to that Sunshine List, they just need to contact our office and we can get them added to that. Also, just as a reminder, we do have some videos and podcasts on our website. If they will go to the Rockingham County Board of Elections website and go under voter information, there is some videos that are listed there. You click on that link and they can view it there. We also have podcasts that are available on there, and I'll be conducting a podcast with Mike Moore this Thursday morning at 9:45 about the upcoming election. So we are still trying to get that information out. Yesterday, we received some videos from the State Board of Elections that goes over information for observers and what the expectations are for observers, how many are allowed in the sites. That information was sent to the political party chairs yesterday. It was late afternoon, and I will also send that information out to the board members and out to the Sunshine List today. Those videos will also be posted on our website with our other videos, and the State Board is trying to make more of these videos. Also, we have been in talks with our precinct officials about doing something that was brought up earlier in the meeting during public comments, of trying to answer some of the questions that they are asked during voting, that maybe we'll be able to answer those, and we'll be posting those on Facebook. So Rockingham County Board of Elections does have a Facebook page, so please check that out. And again, check the website periodically and check your emails. If you're on the Sunshine List, we're trying to send that information out. But is there any questions on the 2024 general election information? Okay. Moving on, the photo ID exception forms have been revised by the State Board of Elections. I included the new forms in your packet. The main change at the very top, there was a statement in the old photo ID exception form, and that's with absentee voting and in-person voting. The statement originally said your vote will count if you truthfully complete and sign this form. Now it states you will meet the photo ID requirement if you truthfully complete and sign this form. We could not make the statement that it will count because there may have been some other thing that caused the vote to not count. That's why that was changed on both of those photo ID exception forms for absentee voting and in-person voting. But are there any questions on that?
Question somewhat related to this. Okay. Could you help me answer a question I've had from several sources? How many in our previous elections, recent elections, how many have really used this form rather than show their photo ID?
We have not had a lot, but we have had a few. During the last election, most of the ones that use this photo ID exception form were in the nursing homes and those facilities. We did have a few that had lost their photo ID or did not have a photo ID. They didn't make it to our office before election day to get their photo ID. If you would like a photo ID, our office is printing those Monday through Friday from 8 to 5. You do not have to have an appointment to get that photo ID. If you are a registered voter in Rockingham County, you come into the office, you fill out one short form, we take your photo, we print your ID, and you leave with that ID that same day. If you are not a registered voter, you fill out a registration form, we will send you a voter verification form. Once your residency is verified, then we can get you a photo ID made. And usually that is within a week to 10 days that it takes for the mail for you to get that verification card. Once that verification card has gone past that 10-day period, we're able to do that photo ID, and you will have that in time for the election. And we've had a lot of people to come by recently and get their photo IDs, so we encourage you to do that.
Follow-up questions, Madam Chair. With the photo ID, we do not keep a record of saying how many use the exception form. We do not keep a record of how many we have. Is that what I'm hearing?
And I'm sorry, I did not answer that. With a provisional ballot, it is listed as an exception form. So, yes, there is a way of pulling that information. We would have to do that as a, it could be requested as a public records request, but yes, we can do that.
Am I incorrect in saying that we as a board get to review all of those?
That is correct. The board reviews.
That being the case, it's been very small.
It has been. We can't, as staff members, approve a photo ID exception form. The board is the only ones, and you do that during the absentee ballot process and during the provisional ballot approval process.
That's so what I really wanted to get out there, yes, in the public, because there are some questions that we're having a lot of them, and I said, no, I don't believe that's true. I think it's a very small number.
That is correct. We have a very small number of the photo ID. Most of our voters are showing up with one or two forms of photo ID. They are very well prepared.
Thank you.
And, of course, the process is being followed by the letter.
Yes.
If anybody has any question. And you can always come and sit and watch. And you'll see it all.
Yes, yes. All right, so is there any other questions? And thank you for that. I'm sorry I didn't answer it correctly the first time.
You did answer it correctly.
Okay.
The ID cards, the required new one that we are supposed to have, it's by May 2025, is that correct?
You're talking about the state?
Yeah.
It's been changing every year, but yes, it is May 2025. That is when the new starred driver's license and the identification cards are through the state.
So that ID card supersedes like your passport, using that as an ID?
It doesn't supersede the passport for going overseas, but it is used in the airlines for in-state domestic flights. From what I understand, that star speeds up the process at the airlines.
But not our ID.
It's not our ID.
Our ID.
No, it is a state ID.
Make anybody think that they can come and get one from us.
No, that's through the DMV. So, but that is a valid photo ID for voting. But are there any other questions? Okay. The next thing is the North Carolina State Board of Elections Summer Conference was held on August the 4th through the 6th at the Koury Convention Center in Greensboro. All of this board, as well as our three staff members, attended. We did not have to go on Sunday. They canceled most of the activities Sunday night, but we were there on Monday and Tuesday. There was a lot of information that was given. We had several breakout sessions that each of us attended. But now I'll just give the board members the opportunity if you want to share anything that you may have learned or thought was good information that was handed out. Or not.
I was amazed at the number of people that were there. And I didn't get a count, but probably 800 or 900 people.
Yes.
It was 700.
It was 700.
How much?
700.
700.
700.
Mm. That's 500 board members. If you figure 100 counties times five board members, plus staff and all that, a lot of people.
Yeah.
And a lot of folks wanting to sell us services.
Yes, so we did. Yes. But, okay. All right, well, moving on, the SAFE assessment. At our last meeting, I had informed you that the state emergency management had come into our office and did a SAFE assessment. Due to the tropical storms that have been occurring, they got a little bit behind. I did finally receive the SAFE assessment late yesterday afternoon. This SAFE assessment is a document that is confidential, so we will have to have a closed session in order to go over this information. And what I can do is make sure that each of you get a copy of this and we can go over that information at our September meeting during a closed session, if that is okay with this board.
Yes.
Okay. All right, but moving to the next thing, the Board of Elections renovation, we have our new carpet in our new early voting facility, training room, boardroom, whatever you want to call it. It looks really nice. For those of you who have not seen it as of yet, please come by and look at it. The ones of you that have seen it, I think you were pleased. We actually had the county to come by and look at it and are now looking at the other areas of carpeting, and hopefully we will be getting new carpeting for the rest of the office either this fiscal year or the next fiscal year, depending on funding that is available. But so if you see county management or the Board of Commissioners, please thank them for that. It is a very much needed asset. It is very nice. It smells clean, and but it's very appealing. I hope that the voters will see the difference and be very pleased with what we have to offer them coming up pretty soon with the early voting. So, but again, please come by and check it out. And that's to the public as well. If they would like to see it, we welcome you to do that. But are there any questions?
How are our neighbors? The sharing of the building, is that working okay as we hoped?
That is working well. We hardly hear anything. So when they put the buffers up, they did a great job. We may occasionally hear a weight fall, but that's it. But there's no distractions from them at all. Very respectful, and you know, as far as their parking, everything has been really well. And it's, and I like the fact that the sheriff's office is actually using the facility, so the sheriff's vehicles are there at different times during the day, so there's a presence there. So it's very good for our office.
For voting purposes, do we anticipate having to make any requirements for parking?
Yes, and I addressed that during the staff meeting this morning that I'll be getting with county management on the possibility of doing something for the ones that will be using the gym during early voting, because this will be a high turnout for early voting with our facility. So that's already being discussed. Okay. Anything else on the renovation? All right, the next thing is board meetings. Just want the board to think about if you want to start having your meetings, monthly meetings down there. I know we have our absentee board meetings there. The county will be working with me as well as Roy on trying to make those meetings live so that it will not be any difference in having a live meeting or having to view it later. We're not sure if it's going to work, but it will be a test run to make sure that you'll be able to be heard and that it is audible enough that you can understand what is being conducted during the meetings. But we'll run a test and see how it goes. And that's the next item on the agenda. Our September board meeting will be moving it from the 17th to the 24th. This room is not available on the 24th at 10 o'clock, so I guess we can test it on September the 24th to see if the public would be able to hear a live meeting at the Board of Elections office, if that is okay with this board.
I have a concern. That's the last meeting before we start early voting. If it can't be heard and can't be seen, is that going to be perceived as a, why did you change your agenda? Not your agenda, but your location.
The location is because this room will not be available the day we have our meeting. It will still be posted on our website just like it normally is, and it's usually posted within 2 to 3 days, sometimes the same day. It depends on how quickly that information gets back to us. But most of our meetings, as you know, are 10 to 15 minutes, and we do encourage people, if they really want to hear it firsthand, they can come to a public meeting. It is open to everyone to view these meetings. But I will let you know, it will not be in the new meeting room because we have precinct official training that day as well. So it will be in the regular board meeting room. So
change this date from the 20th to the 24th.
Yes.
Can we not change it to a Monday or a Tuesday, or I mean a Wednesday date rather than the 24th?
That's up to you.
Pretty much go along with that, because I don't want it said that we are hiding something. So if we can change the date or change the time so that we can be sure that it's being seen, it's out there, I agree with it. And I don't know about the other two, but...
You agree with the 24th?
No, with changing it so that we can... Yeah.
We can do that. I'll get with the clerk to the board and see what other date, and Roy, to see if there is another date. I know Mondays for Roy are pretty busy because of other board meetings, but we can check into that. So
I think that would be a better option than put us in the little room on the last meeting that we're going to have before the early voting.
Well, you look at your schedules first. Let me know what your availability is for the week of the 23rd of September, and then I will pursue it with the clerk to the board and with Roy. Is there anything else? Because I do have a few other things, if that's all right. Okay. At our last meeting, we talked about Senate Bill 88 and House Bill 1071. Nothing has changed since our last board meeting. It is still just like that. The Senate bill passed the Senate and has been sent to the House, but the House has not taken it up as of yet. And the House Bill 1071 was passed by the House, sent to the Senate, but the Senate has not moved forward with it as of yet.
Refresh our memory.
What those are about.
88 and 1071.
Okay, Senate Bill 88 was regarding various election changes. That was the pilot program on the verification of voter signatures on absentee ballots. actually instituting a software to help with that verification process. There are 10 counties in the state of North Carolina that are conducting this pilot program, but this bill was to make it a law that all 100 counties would have to purchase that software to verify those signatures.
How expensive is that software?
You had a question about that.
I heard how much the software would cost, and that would be a county expense, not a state expense.
But we don't know what the cost is.
No, sir, not as of this moment.
Successful that has been with the 10 counties.
They're still testing it. This general election is going to be the big test. They did do testing during the primary and the second primary, but the general election is going to be the best test to see how successful this software is. So it will run through with those 10 counties through this general election. So if it does become law, we would start next year in the 2025 municipal election. And then the House Bill 1071 was regarding certain voter rolls and the maintenance list and things like that, that they're wanting increased verifications on. But again, it has not passed the Senate. It has not actually been presented to the Senate as of yet. So are there any other questions on that?
Just for a comment, Madam Chair. Okay. This is a typical standoff. One bill in one House and one bill in the Senate, and they're holding each other hostage. That's usually what happens. It sounds kind of childish, but it's fact.
Okay.
I've seen it personally.
Just want to remind everyone about the constitutional amendment that will be on the ballots this election. And the constitutional amendment is for or against, and the statement will be Constitution Amendment to provide that only a citizen of the United States who is 18 years of age and otherwise possessing the qualifications for voting shall be entitled to vote at any election in this state. That will be on the second page of the ballot. It is the last item on the ballot. So when individuals do come out to vote, it is a two-page ballot, and it's 14 inches long. So just don't stop with the front page. There's more on the back. This is a very long ballot. The ballots still have not been approved through the state board. We're still going through that process. I have not been able to start the process of approvals. There is a four-step approval for each ballot. I've asked for changes on some of our ballots. Some of our ballots we didn't need. There were ballots that we did need, but we will have ballots in our office by September 6th to go out for absentee mail-out ballots. Fingers crossed. A lot of prayers going up. But just want to make you aware, every county is going through this. It's not just Rockingham. And the reason for this, we did have some new parties that have come on board, and I'll give you that update now. You know that as of July the 9th, the state board recognized the Constitution Party as a new party. At a later meeting, they approved We the People as a political party, and they did not approve Justice for All as a political party. Well, both of those were challenged. The We the People was challenged and sent to the state court, and the state court upheld the decision by the state board and approved that We the People should be allowed to be a political party and be a part of the general election this fall. The Justice for All Party suit went to federal court, and the federal court reversed the decision from the State Board of Elections and approved Justice for All as a new political party. So we now have 9 political parties in the state of North Carolina, the 9th one being unaffiliated. But I just wanted to make you aware of that. And Justice for All, We the People, and the Constitution Party do have representation on the ballot for the general election. So I think that is all for my updates. Okay, but if there are any questions.
I'd like to back up to your amendment. You said that would be on the ballot.
Yes.
What provisions will be made to be sure that everyone who receives a ballot knows that there's a part, extra part that they need to look at?
We will be having training on the ballot station area, and this is one of the things that we will be discussing, that they remind the individuals to look at both sides and that we do have a constitutional amendment on that ballot. Again, I will let you know this. This is a voting ballot. It is everyone's own decisions. If they choose not to vote for a particular contest, that is their right. The same thing with the constitutional amendment. They can vote for it, against it, or leave it blank. It's just like any other part of the ballot. Because we have had a few people call the office and ask, do I have to vote on the constitutional amendment? No.
Okay, so. I think each of us realized that it's everyone's choice.
Yes.
What they vote for, how they vote.
Yeah.
But it still becomes our responsibility to make sure that they know that it is there.
Yes,
so
ma'am.
So they can't say, no one told me it was there, and that's how I missed it. I'm just saying, we just want to make sure that we cover
everything,
all bases.
And also, as soon as our sample ballots are made available, they will be posted on our website. We will have sample ballots in our office, so if anyone is needing those, they will be made available on the website for them to print out. At home, they will be in the 8.5 by 11 instead of the 14. We will make it so that it's easily printed at home if they want to do that, or they can come by our office, or we can mail them to them as well.
Madam Chair, a question and a comment. On the ballot with the amendment, has there been any movement by the state board or legislature or anyone in the state to find a way to determine, other than just a little check mark on the ballot saying I verify that I'm a citizen, that we can verify individuals who are not citizens?
No.
Virginia has done that, and they've come up with several ways of doing that. It looks like to me every person who is here and legal to vote as a citizen either has a birth certificate or they have a certificate from the Immigration Service that they have passed all the requirements, and they have a certificate for that purpose. It looks like to me we ought to have some way that if someone is challenged, it's not just based on, you know, their appearance or whatever, that we would have a way to check that.
The last I was told is they do not have the database to do that verification.
But we're putting the law in, and then we're not making any way to determine that.
Who put the law in? Who put the law in?
Somebody that needed feel good.
So So they are probably the ones that we need to contact.
Well, they put it in because some cities are now incorporating that, that anyone who lives there and is a resident can vote. And that's not what the federal constitution says. So it's making it so that in North Carolina, the cities cannot establish rules that's contrary to the constitution.
Well, the very first question that is asked on the registration or voter registration is, are you a resident of the United States? Mm-hmm. Are you a citizen of the United States? So that is the very first question, and it does have to be checked, yes or no. If it is not checked, we have to send it back to them. They have to check that, yes or no.
And if it's we reject it.
We do. And at the bottom, when they sign, there is a statement or an oath that they take that everything on that registration form is accurate and truthful. So when they sign and date that, they are stating that the information on that registration form is correct.
And we have no way to verify that.
We have to just have faith in the system.
And it's beyond our control.
Yes.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
They have to live with themselves. So.
And the consequences.
Yes, and there are consequences if you are caught.
Okay, I have email that was sent to me earlier today saying that September 17th is the National Voter Registration Day, and I haven't had a chance to check it out, but I just did want to make that announcement.
Yes, and it should be on your calendars. Did I have that on your calendar?
Yes, ma'am, it is on that calendar.
Okay.
So it's now been verified.
Yes.
Thank you. All right, if there is no more, do we have any more questions or concerns for Paula?
Yes, Madam Chair, I'd like to be recognized for a couple of comments.
Okay.
I think number one, our person who spoke today told us something that we didn't know, that all the literature is back behind the glass. I think we ought to direct staff to consider conversation with the management of the county to put that to the, you know, put those handouts on a table out there. I know that from time to time when you come in, there's people got groceries up there they're selling, farm products and such as that. So I think they could, at least they could do is put that out there. And I think the second comment I've got is, we're unfortunate in our in our county that we do not have a media that is pretty well covers the county. And I think that staff should contact the State Board of Elections with their ultimate resources and people to do things to put forth some kind of communication on a weekly or a daily basis encouraging people to vote. We don't have that resource here. And if the county, if the state could do it, they issue it as a release, and it's picked up by radio stations, TV stations along the way. We're fighting a battle that's hard to win with people when they don't even know they're supposed to go somewhere else to vote other than the Board of Elections on Election Day. So I think that these are the kind of things that, with their ultimate resources, they ought to be able to come up with some kind of a program where they could issue press releases that are rock and cause somebody to say, well, maybe I need to go vote. Maybe I need to register, that kind of thing.
Thank you for your comment.
I support that. I think we definitely need it. We do have Rockingham now that does publish But it isn't getting the support from individuals and groups that I think it needs in order to really be totally profitable and produce a paper that we can get on a regular basis. Of course, we also have the News and Record that publishes a Rockingham County section, but it's not fully, that's not a good solution.
But I do want to remind you that when it's almost time for the election primary or the general election, you have the yard signs, you have signs everywhere, and that's a reminder as well, but it doesn't tell them where to go. But you would think that they would check into where I need to go to vote. So that's one determining factor that they can, that's out there that they could use. And so let's hope that this will be something you could check into and see if that's something that the state board might want to.
Do we post on Facebook?
Yes. And I will let you know that we sent out information to over 30 organizations as well outside of the senior centers. We've sent information to the chambers of commerce, like I said, the senior centers, nutrition centers, the transit services, Salvation Army, the North Carolina Works, the Outreach Center, the Rockingham Hope. All of the towns and cities have received information. So we've been trying to get all of this out into the public. And like the last meeting, if anyone who is listening needs information sent, let us know and we'll send that information out. We've also sent information out to the nursing homes and the care facilities as well. So.
And the political parties.
And the political parties, yes.
Now we've got nine.
I only have contact for three in Rockingham County. I'm not aware of the other parties having a local party, but if they would please contact us and we could get them on our mailing list and on our sunshine list as well.
Okay, so we're at the point where we're ready for adjournment. I want to take my hat off to the commissioners and county management for all that they're doing for the Board of Elections office building. It does look good. It's even going to look better once we get additional carpet that matches the carpet that's in the larger meeting room. That the space is just tremendous, and I'm taking my hat off to them because we do appreciate all the things that they've done to make things look really professional in the Board of Elections office space. Thank you. At this time, I'd like to entertain a motion for adjournment.
I'll move.
Second.
It has been moved and properly second that we adjourn. Is there any discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. All those who oppose signify by saying nay. The motion carries. It is now 10:59.